Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Janavallabha Girivaradhari. Gopi Janavallabha Girivaradhari. Yashodanandana Braja Janaranjana. Yashodanandana Braja Janaranjana. Jamuna Tira Vanachari. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jayo Gopi Janavallabha Girivaradhari. Yashodanandana Braja Janaranjana. Jamuna Tira Vanachari. Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari.
Jai Om Vishnupad Paramahams Parivrajakacharya Ashtotarshat Shri Srimad His Divine Grace Vahe Charanarvinda Bhakti Vedanta Swami Shal Prabhupad Ki Jai. Jai Om Vishnupad Paramahams Parivrajakacharya Ashtotarshat Shri Srimad His Divine Grace Shri Bhakti Siddhanta Sarasati Goswami Shri Prabhupad Ki Jai. Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai. Namacharya Shri Haridas Thakur Ki Jai. Prem Se Kaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhanityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar. Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopu Gopinath Shamakunda Radha Kunda Giri Govardhan Ki. Braj Bhumi Shri Vrindavan Dham Ki Jai. Navdeep Mayapur Dham Ki Jai. Purushottam Kshetra Shri Jagannath Puri Dham Ki Jai. Ganga Mai Jamuna Mai Ki Jai. Bhakti Devi Srimati Tulsi Maharani Ki Jai. Samaveta Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. Dai Gaur Premanandi. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories, all glories, all glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. Om Agyanti Mirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupaha Kadamahiyam Dadati Swapadantikam. I'm sorry. Narayanam namaskrityam naram chaiva narottamam devim sarasvatim vyasam tato jayamudiraye nashta prayeshu bhadreshu nityam bhagavata sevaya bhagavati uttamah shloke bhaktir bhavati naishtaki Krishnaya Vasudevaya Devaki Nandanaya cha Nanda Gopakumaraya Govindaya Namo Namaha Shrinvatam Sokatha Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtana Hridyantasthoya Bhadrani Vidhunoti Surit Satam. Hare Krishna. So today we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, 11th canto, chapter number 16th, entitled The Lord's Opulences, verse number 33. Vishvavasuh Purvachittir Gandharvapsarasamaham Bhudharanamaham Sthairyam Gandhamatram aham bhuvah Vishvavasu purvachittir Gandharvapsarasamaham Bhudharanamaham sthairyam Gandhamatram aham bhuvah Vishvavasu purvachittir Gandharvapsarasamaham Bhudharanamaham sthairyam Gandhamatramaham bhuvah. Gandharvapsarasamaham Bhudharanamaham sthairyam Gandhamatram aham bhuva. Matajis Vishvavasuh purvachittir Gandharvapsarasamaham Bhudharanamaham sthairyam Gandhamatram aham bhavah. Word to word translation. Vishvavasu. Vishvavasu. Purvachittihi. Purvachitti. Gandharva apsarasam. Among the Gandharvas and Apsaras. Aham. I am. Bhudharanam. Of the mountains. Aham. I am sthairyam, the steadiness, gandhamatram, the perception of aroma, aham, I am, bhuvah, of the earth. Translation and purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Among the Gandharvas, I am Vishvavasu,
And I am Purvachitti among the heavenly Apsaras. I am the steadiness of mountains and the fragrant aroma of the earth. Purport. In Bhagavad Gita, chapter 7, verse 9, Lord Krishna says, Punyo Gandha Prithivyam Cha, I am the fragrance of the earth. The original fragrance of the earth is very pleasing and represents Lord Krishna. Although unpleasant aromas may be artificially produced, they do not represent the Lord. Om Ajnanti Mirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupaha Kadamahiyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yutapada Kamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathan Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhan Vitamscha Hare Krishna Karuna Sindhu Deena Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostate Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vanchagalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Vyevacha Patitanam Bhavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. So we are reading this chapter entitled The Lord's Opulences, where the Lord is speaking about His various opulences which are manifest in this material world. So basically, these opulences are manifest in terms of knowledge, strength, beauty, and so on, influence, like that. So, in the beginning of the chapter, Uddhav ji, he praises the Lord. He says that you are the source of everything, you are the source of creation, annihilation, right? And you are all pervading. So, he asks that, how can I constantly remember you? And how can I perceive you in your different, you know, manifestations, in what are the different forms in which the great sages also worship you? So this is his question, and then Lord Krishna starts answering, and Lord Krishna acknowledges that this is the very same question which was asked by Arjun also on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, where he was ready to fight with his relatives, of course, under his direction for the establishment of Dharma. So, he also asked this same question, and there, if we refer the Bhagavad Gita, we see that Krishna, Arjun, first he starts with the conclusion. He says that Param Brahma, Param Dhamma, Pavitram, Paramam Bhavan. He says that I accept you, that you are the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and that, you know, everything is you are the source, you are the Param Dhamma, you are the all pure, everything. And then he says that, how can I constantly remember the same question. How can I constantly remember you in the different manifestations in this world? And then Krishna starts speaking that chapter also, the 10th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. So, generally, when the question of God, the belief in God comes, so there are two parties, the believers and the non-believers. And generally, the non-believers always have this question, where is God? Can you show me God? Does God exist? If I can see God, then I will believe. So, this is also a question. But then, the basic premise from where this question comes is that there is no God. The question is in the mood of a challenge. That if God is existing, I would have seen Him. But the fact that I can't see, so He does not exist. Or if He exists, then the logic is applied that you show me. So, this inquiry is actually not an inquiry for understanding or learning, but it is a challenge, basically. So, the conclusion is already there in the question. The answer is already there, that God does not exist, because you can't show me. But, this is the way, those who don't want to accept God, so they create these kind of, as the word is very common these days, the narrative. So the demoniac people, they create these narratives that seeing is believing. If you can't see, then you don't have to believe. We can't see God, so you don't have to believe in God. And so when God is not there, you can't see Him, then you can do whatever you want. Enjoy. And you are not responsible. Or you don't have to necessarily, be accountable anywhere, because there is no one, right? There is no authority. So that's the basic, thought of a conditioned soul, that it wants to defy authority. I seek humble, blessings from Her Grace Rukmini Mataji, a very senior disciple of Srila Prabhupada. I'm sorry I did not acknowledge you. Please forgive me. Please give your blessings so that I can speak something which is, in the line of parampara. So, there is a story which I could not find the exact reference, but we have heard many times that Prabhupada used to say this story of a court jester. So whether it was Gopal Bhan or Birbal, I don't remember that. But the story is that this, whatever name we say, let's say Gopal Bhan. So he was, with his wit, he had gained so much, favors, or became so much dear to the king, that king would just pay attention to him and would not be, giving any attention to the other ministers. And the ministers, they became very envious of this person. And then they started plotting, what should we do so that all the attention which this fellow is taking, we can also get some favors from the king. So they all came together, they plotted that we have to somehow eliminate him. But if we kill him and if we get caught, so that will be very dangerous. So they schemed that we will not allow him to come in our kingdom. We will tell him. So they plotted that, they said that, the king has removed you from the kingdom because he is not happy with you. And to the king So they would not allow him to come to the court, even to the kingdom. So they had made all the setting with the guard and from bottom to top. And to the king they said that he is sick. That's why he is not attending the court. And that continued for some time. And then at one point they said that actually Gopal Bhana has died. And this fellow, he was constantly thinking, you know, what's happening? Why the king is not allowing to meet? You know, I was such a favorite. So then he knew that at one particular day, the king goes for a tour of the kingdom, on sitting on his elephant. So he knew the exact route. So he climbed up a tree, because in some other processions also, when he wanted to come near the king, so no one would allow him. So he climbed up the tree to get the attention of the king. And when the king was passing, so the Gopal Bhan on the tree branch, he started waving, "I am here, you know, why are you not allowing me inside? What happened?" You know, like that. So the other ministers, they started shouting, "See, we were telling you that Gopal Bhana has died and now he has become a ghost." And the king believed. So basically, a particular thing spoken for a very long time, that becomes a narrative, and then, you know, people start believing it. So also, you know, this logic that if you can't sleep, if you can't see, you don't have to believe. But there is a research documentary, a 1 hour video which is made by BBC on is seeing believing, and it's very interesting, well researched, and the conclusion, I don't have anything to show some clips of the video, but it's very convincing, and it's a fact. The conclusion is that seeing is literally believing, because we see what we believe. If we believe that there is a fault in certain person, then we only see that. We don't see any other good quality. And as some days back, in his class, our Avatar Leela Prabhu was mentioning that actually, if a person has love, he gave the example of mother. Mother loves the child so much that with all the faults that others may speak about the child, but still she finds something by which, you know, the child is very dear to the mother. She'll always see some good quality in the son because of her love, because she believes that he is good, you know. So what we believe, actually we see that. So in the conditioned state, we want to believe that God does not exist. And that's why we can't see God. But, when the senses are purified, when the desire is purified, then Krishna manifests. Because in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that I deserve the right to whom I reveal myself. Not everyone can see me or understand me as I am. And this is corroborated by Srila Prahlad Maharaj. So we see that in the 7th canto, this story is narrated that Prahlad Maharaj, he started preaching in the classroom of Shandai and Amarka. And then when he was brought to his father, and reported that, you know, Hiranyakashipu was reported that he is preaching about Vishnu. So then Hiranyakashipu asked, "Where have you got this knowledge from? This is not taught by your teachers. So where did you get this understanding? You have actually spoiled our family name." So then Prahlad Maharaj says, "Matirna Krishne Paratah Svatova Mitho Bipadyeta Grihavritanam Adanta Gobhir Vishtam Tamashram Punas Punas Charvita Charvananam." That those who don't have the desire to know Krishna, so the literal translation is that Prahlad Maharaj replied, because of their uncontrolled senses, persons too addicted to materialistic life make progress towards hellish conditions and repeatedly chew that which has already been chewed. Their inclinations toward Krishna are never aroused, either by instructions of others, by their own efforts, or by a combination of both. So because their inclination is not there towards the Lord, because of their tendency to be, you know, adant gobhir, because the senses are uncontrolled, because there is a great desire to enjoy through the senses, so the inclination towards the Lord is not aroused either by their own effort or by combined effort. So, because the inclination is towards sense enjoyment and not towards self-realization or towards serving the Lord, but serving our own senses. So that is the reason why Prahlad Maharaj, as a small 5-year-old child, could see Krishna everywhere. But Hiranyakashipu could not see, because actually he did not want to see. There was no inclination. And it is mentioned that in one of the Subhashit, it says that Yasya nasti svayam pragya shastra tasya karoti kim lochanabhyam vihinasya darpana kim karishyati. That what is the use of knowledge of shastras if one does not actually have the pragya or the intellectual capacity to understand, the inclination to understand. Just like what good a mirror can do to a person who does not have eyes. What is the fault of the mirror? There is a similar verse which mentions that, you know, there is a tree which is called as karir or karil, that is found very, you know, that is found in Vrindavan, in that area, and Mathura and all these places. So it's a tree which only has stems, there are no leaves. So a karir tree, it does not blossom any flowers or leaves even in spring, so that is not the fault of the spring. And in the daylight, if the owl cannot see, so that is not the fault of the sun. And during rain, when the chataka, it is actually opening the mouth, but the mouth is so small, the water does not fall sometimes, so that is not the fault of the rain. So similarly, if a person is actually not inclined, if does not want to see God, God is not at fault. So there are, in this chapter, Krishna actually gives so many places and reasons where we can actually see God, we can actually realize God. But the first premise or the first prerequisite is that, are we actually ready to see? Are we willing to see the Lord? And in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna mentions that he, whatever kind of faith that we have, he strengthens our faith. So if we want to serve the Lord, then Krishna says, Dadami buddhi yogam tam, yena mam upayanti te. That I give him the necessary intelligence by which he can come to me. And if a person is not inclined towards the Lord, then he also gives that kind of determination by which he can find reasons or logic by which, you know, he can defy the existence of God. And so in these verses, although the Lord is transcendental, beyond this manifest creation, but he is mentioning in these verses that he actually can be perceived in this world, and you know, through our present senses. Because, you know, sometimes there are some philosophies, they mention that actually God cannot come in this world. You know, this material world is not a good place, so God does not come here. So you can't see God, you can't experience God, you can't, you know, realize God through, you know, your senses. You just have to believe. Your belief not necessarily have or should give an experience. But that's kind of, you know, little absurd, because that becomes like, you know, you just follow something fanatically without actually getting any realization. So a similar kind of, you know, thing we hear sometimes, that or we kind of, you know, believe in it, that you know, there are different evidences or proof by which we can understand God. And we see, we know that, you know, there are these three basic proofs, that is Pratyaksha, Anuman and Shabda. So that is empirical evidence and logic and reasoning, inference, and then finally the Shabda or the scriptural injunctions. And yes, it's a fact that Shabda is the highest and the best form of evidence. But all these different evidences, they are not supplementary to each other, but they are actually complementary. Because, you know, whatever we hear in Shabda, which is, you know, the most authoritative understanding of God, is given by the God Himself. Is given by the Lord Himself through the different scriptures. And then that will become realization through our experience. Because if we can't experience God, then we can't realize God. In fact, the word realization is you know, translated in Sanskrit, or rather Sanskrit is translated into realization. The Sanskrit word is sakshatkar. And sakshat literally means pratyaksha, means something which you can actually perceive. So sakshatkar or realization means, you know, you can actually experience the Lord. And to experience the Lord in the right way or in the most authentic way, then we have to have the understanding first. That unless we know, so it's just like you have to search. If someone asks that, you know, search for a lost ring, so then the question is where first, you know, where to search, right? So similarly, you know, when we want to understand the Lord, first we should know how to understand the Lord, right? We want to search the Lord, so we should know the means by which, or the proper knowledge by which we can understand the Lord. So that knowledge cannot be based on our senses or our mind, but that comes from the authoritative sources, the Lord Himself. And then that knowledge, that understanding, when it is you know, based, or it is you know, experienced through our senses, then it becomes realization. So here in this chapter and also in the 10th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna mentions that whatever is the you know, most superior, the most powerful thing in this world, in this creation, that you can see in any class or category, that is nothing but just a fraction of my opulence, the manifestation of a fraction of my opulence, my vibhuti. So anything which is you know, superior in any way or form, that is because that ability or that quality is derived from the Lord. That is a reflection of the Lord's opulence. So, you know, it's like just gathering knowledge from Pratyaksha and Anuman will be faulty because our senses are faulty. But if we have some philosophy or some understanding which cannot be realized through our senses, then it will not be appealing. It will be a fanatical following only, right? So both the things have to be complemented and not supplemented. So the Shabda is then experienced through pratyaksha and understood with some logic, not all logic, because just logic is not sufficient. And we see that that's how in both these chapters, Uddhav as well as Arjun, they start that you are the super soul, you are the supreme personality of Godhead. And now, how can I perceive you and your manifestations in this world through the means that I have now, that is these senses, right? And when, with this understanding, when we start relating with the things in this world, trying to see Krishna in each and every of these manifestations, that's how our senses get purified. Because, you know, the knowledge is coming down in a process of hearing, shravanam, by, you know, the process of hearing, when we hear from our spiritual master, our authorities, spiritual authorities, that's how, you know, our senses actually become purified, as mentioned in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, that actually God is there with each and every one of us. Nitya Siddha Krishna Prema Sadhya Kapunai. The love for the Lord is there in each and everyone's heart. But right now it is covered by so many different misconceptions that we have, that we are this body, that we are the enjoyer, the master, right, and the proprietor of everything. So this misconceptions, when they are purified, Shravanadi Shuddha Chitte Karaye Udaye. When the Chitta or Chetana or the consciousness gets purified from the understanding that I am the master to the understanding that I am masters, I am the servant of the master, not the master. So then we can actually get this realization. Then you know, the stage is described by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in his conversations with Ramananda Rai about when they are discussing about the different levels of devotees. So he mentions that what is the you know, symptom of a person who is a Uttam Adhikari or a Mahabhagavat. So he says, Sthavar Jangam Dekhe Na Dekhe Tar Murti Sarvatra Hai Nija Ishta Deve Sphurti. That such a Mahatma, he sees both the moving and non-moving things, the forms, the material forms, but actually he does not see the form. The Mahabhagavat, advanced devotee, certainly sees everything mobile and immovable, but does not exactly see their forms. Rather, everywhere he immediately sees manifest the form of the Supreme Lord. So, because the consciousness is there, he is fully Krishna conscious, that in whatever such a Mahabhagavat sees, he only sees Krishna. And to give a very simple example of this, Srila Prabhupada once gave an example, asked the disciples that if you see specks, my specks, on the table, what do you remember? Srila Prabhupada, we remember you. And if you see shoes, if you see the cane, right? So whatever, you know, we relate, we understand what is the relation between those things and the Lord, then by seeing the thing, we can actually remember the Lord. Just like just seeing the spectacles of Srila Prabhupada, the disciple, remembers Prabhupada and remembers that these are the specs that Prabhupada uses while translating the Srimad Bhagavatam, and like that. So essentially, for seeing, it is not just the seeing through the eyes, but it is seeing through the ears, seeing through the proper authentic knowledge and understanding. And that is what Brahmaji also speaks in the Brahma Samhita, Primanjana Churita Bhakti Vilochanena, that a saintly devotee whose eyes are smeared with the ointment of love for the Lord, then he sees Krishna everywhere and he sees Krishna manifested in his own heart. So, in this chapter, when Krishna is describing of all these different opulences, that among the Gandharvas I am Vishwavasu and among the Apsaras I am Purvachitti. So, it is not literally in the sense that these two personalities are Krishna, but what they represent, that is the opulence of Krishna. So, in the third chapter, in the third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, when the Visarga or the secondary creation is described, so it is mentioned that Brahmaji, out of his own pleasure, he created these two personalities. Among the Gandharvas, those who sing very well, those who sing very beautifully. So, Gandharva, Vishwavasu is the chief, because he represents the art of singing to its highest level. And of those who are very good dancers, Apsaras, so of that, Purvachitti is the best. This is, she was created by the Lord Brahmaji himself, the first created being, because that represents the highest art in dancing. And in the purport, Prabhupada mentions that when singing and dancing is for sense gratification, then it is demoniac. But the same singing and dancing, when it is for the pleasure of the Lord, especially in Harinam Sankirtan, that is Krishna conscious. And that is actually the best way of pleasing the Lord. You know, it's bhakti, it's an ang of bhakti. So, you know, because this singing and dancing is actually very natural and it's, you know, in the heart, and that thing can, you know, give pleasure to the Lord, because, you know, the natural inclination of the soul is to serve the Lord always, and through every activity, the pleasure of the Lord is manifested for the pure souls. So, you know, when this consciousness of trying to use everything for own selfish purposes is purified, then this pure consciousness actually gets manifest. And we actually see, can experience that just few days back, we had this flower festival. And, you know, the pleasure of the Lord, actually, when we serve the Lord in a very simple, innocent and pure way, that service creates pleasure automatically within us. And we saw that when the flowers were being showered, flower petals were showered on the forms of Radha Gopinath, it was such a pleasing sight. So many devotees sat for so many hours plucking all those petals, and all those petals were showered on the Lord. And that was giving great pleasure to everyone, to such an extent that when this wonderful music, kirtan basically, the glorification of the names of the Lord was going on, devotees had to be said that we will announce when to stand up and dance. So, as soon as the flower shower started, some people actually got up and started dancing. So, they had to be. So, that's natural. And, you know, that's a natural inclination of the soul to feel happy when the Lord is being served. And sometimes, in association of pure devotees, that actually gets manifest. So it's just like, you know, the sun is so powerful that the rays also get reflected on some small, tiny, stones also, and the stone shines, but actually it's the shine of the Lord. So similarly, the pleasure of the Lord by serving the Lord is so much that, you know, that pleasure gets reflected within us also sometimes, even in our unpurified state. So the more we stay in association of devotees, the more purification can come. So the way to understand this whole chapter is that, you know, how we can see, not through the eyes, but see through the understanding of the Shastra, that how everything which is manifest in this world is nothing but the potency of the Lord. And all these things are around us so that we can become Krishna conscious. So, if we are searching for Krishna, we will see Krishna in all these things. But if we are not searching for Krishna, then Krishna will remain hidden. As Uddhavji mentions in one of the verses, a few verses earlier, that you remain hidden from everyone, although you are all pervading. And no one can see you, but you see everything and everyone. So, these are few thoughts that I had. So, thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jaya. Srimad Bhagavatam ki jaya. One or two, then it can be taken. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jaya.